Möchte ich Hallo zu sagen, somit auch mal Hallo. Also Erik Kessels ist Gründer und Kreativdirektor der Werbeagentur Kessels Kramer in Amsterdam. Darüber hinaus ist Erik Kessels aber auch ein begeisterter Sammler fotografischer Werke und aufgrund dieser Passion haben wir ihn heute hier zu uns nach Dortmund eingeladen. Er publizierte unter anderem The Instant Man Wonder, 2 Kilo auf Kessels Kramer und andere Fotografiebände und kuratierte mehrere Ausstellungen. Seit 2000 ist er Herausgeber des Alternativmagazins Useful Photography. Weitere Informationen gibt es auf der Verlagsseite www.kesselskramerpublishing.com. Ja, tosenden Applaus für Erik Kessels.
We quit this one, no? Can we get rid of this one? No.
Okay.
Okay. Ja, guten Abend. Ich habe es mal auf Deutsch versucht, aber das ist nicht ganz gut gelungen. So I'll switch to English. Thanks for the invitation. First, before I go to my passion for books, and I'll just introduce myself a little bit to what I do in the office and as a designer and art director. Again, as you said, started an agency called Kessels Kramer in 1996, and we are based in Amsterdam. We work in a church in the center of Amsterdam. It's quite nice for your parents because you can say that you go every day to the church. So, but it's like an open space that we made like a little bit like our playground. We work there with about 30 people, and since 4 years we also have an office in London. That's called KK Outlet, and this is like a shop, a gallery, and an office in one. I'll show you a few works that I did over the last years. This campaign for diesel jeans, where we focused on the fact that people nowadays want to stay younger and younger constantly. So we gave kind of tips how people can stay younger. In this case, it's by drinking urine. Another client we work for is a budget hotel in the center of Amsterdam, a very bad and shitty hotel. So the only kind of possibility for them to stick out was just to be very honest about what they have and what they don't have. In a way, honesty was their only luxury, so we made posters saying like, now a bed in every room, or now even more rooms without a window, or now even more dog shit in the main entrance. But I don't have all of these because I talk about books today. Another one for the hotel is a poster where we use this classical advertising trick of before and after. So it's a check-in the Hansbrinker Budget Hotel, check-out the Hansbrinker Budget Hotel. And I'll show you one film that we made for the hotel. Thing is, we did the theme and the design for the theme for the city of Amsterdam, and made also this kind of three-dimensional sculpture that is moving around Amsterdam, where people make images in front of. This is also meant to be because Amsterdam doesn't really have like one kind of landmark like London or Paris, so this kind of became a little bit of that landmark because. Yeah, there are now so many pictures on the internet where you can find where people photograph themselves in front of this. The thing we did for a marathon in Berlin for Nike, This was Nike at that time was seen as kind of a big American company, where in Germany predominantly Adidas was the brand. So we came up with the idea of using like the oldest runner of the race, and that was a guy called Heinrich Blümken. And for 3 years we kind of promoted him, and in a way totally the opposite that it normally happens with sports advertising. And yeah, he was always 20 minutes late because he got like stopped by radio and TV interviews. Oh yeah, and to finish this section then quickly on the work that I do as a designer and art director, two commercials. The first one is for a mobile phone company, and this shows a little bit the more social aspect of people when they use a mobile phone, because they don't have an eye for what's happening around them anymore. Yeah, and the next one is for a for the World Cup of Football, for a radio station during the World Cup of Football. And mostly you see a lot of, especially in Holland, you see like all these commercial breaks. They are kind of colored orange during the World Cup. We tried to do it a little bit different. Yeah, so far like a small introduction to the work in the office. What I saw like the last maybe 10 years is that the work kind of that you do nowadays, a lot of disciplines are opened also when like you are designers. I mean, years ago a designer would be very stuck in his own discipline, and this is something which changed, I think, now, because as a designer you can work in many different disciplines. I mean, when you have a good idea for an exhibition or for a book or for a product, you can also make that, I think, because there is also because of internet many disciplines are so open, and so also because there are many amateurs who kind of entered the field, and there's not a lot of barriers anymore, and a lot of disciplines are very democratic. I mean, everybody's a photographer, everybody's a designer, only the professional people, I mean, what they have is also to come up with a very good idea. I mean, in a way, after a while, I think that having a very good idea is the strongest thing that you have as a designer or as a photographer or whatever. These are two books that we published, or that was published by a Japanese company, which contain all our work of the agencies of like the last 15 years. And sometimes we also exhibit these works. This was in Milan, in Triennale in Milan. In a way, very strange, because like I think as a advertising agency, or I mean, having an exhibition with that work, I mean, 15 years ago that would be unheard of. I mean, that's but nowadays, I mean, also with the work that you make, it's more possible. And over the years, we moved more and more in coming up with ideas for products. We made a documentary about the two lowest qualified football nations, and also many exhibitions. This is an exhibition I did recently in Amsterdam. It's called Album Beauty, and this is only about like the fading, more to celebrate the fading phenomena of the family album. And yeah, this was like more three-dimensional installation where if you walk through, you kind of feel almost like walking through a family album yourself. This was an exhibition in three places in Europe. It was called Graphic Detour, and this was all about how graphic designers also move into other areas nowadays, that they become sculptors or they become more making products. And so this exhibition was purely dealing on that. And this was an exhibition I did last year in Amsterdam. And what I did here is I collected for 24 hours, I downloaded all the images of Flickr that were uploaded in those 24 hours. And there were 950,000 images, only with the name IMG. So I only downloaded the ones with IMG. And 950,000, and then I printed them for real, like as normal printouts, and then dumped them in a museum. So people could walk through and pick them up and jump in. And it was just like almost a metaphor of how many images we live with nowadays. And yeah, also how because when you walked through, it was very personal almost. I mean, you looked from the outside, it as an installation, it looked very kind of enormous, but walking in, you suddenly pick up these very personal memories that people upload on internet, and the whole discussion of public and private was held a lot with this exhibition. Then we moved to the books, where a lot of people talked already about today. Yeah, since maybe 10 years, we also publish books ourselves. In the beginning, that started because other people didn't want to publish them. So we thought, like, it's quite nice when we do it ourselves then. At least then it gets made. But the books that are made about the work that we do in the office, those are made by other publishers, because I think that's also, I mean, to make a book about your own work is a bit patting on your own shoulder, so I don't really see that happening. And today I'll just show you some examples. This is one book that I did in the beginning, also with the fascination of images that people kind of, when you still had these 24-hour print shops, you people just left images that were printed in there because they thought they were wrong and they were mistakes. So for many years I collected, and I had some people working in these shops who just kept the photographs that people left in there. And so for instance, this one is an image of a woman that was really pissed off when she came in, when she saw that image, because she took a roll of 24 photographs in her camera on holiday. And then she didn't know, but after the first image, the negative got stuck. So she shot the whole holiday on one image. And then she saw this when she got to the print shop. Also, you see a lot of double exposures, like with two accidentally exposed photographs on one image. Or this quite funny ones. I mean, you don't understand why people throw these away, why they don't want them, because they, in my mind, they are better than the normal pictures. This one, for instance, talking about the decisive moment earlier. This is also a very decisive moment. I mean, very stupid but beautiful images that you never could take. Also, like almost horror posters for films and other horror films. Yeah, and this one also very beautiful, I think. Yeah, another series of magazines or books that we make is called Useful Photography. And this comes from the fascination of certain imagery that we live with every day, like images that are in brochures or that are in catalogs that you get on your doormat. But in a way, we kind of almost consume these images and don't even look at them anymore. We don't know the names of the photographers who made them. So we thought it's nice to have a magazine, which is a place for these kind of almost forgotten or abandoned photographs. So we collected these, and for instance, this image is, I mean, I love this image because it's, for me, I had it like also for some month, like printed out very big and hanging above my bench at home. I mean, after a while, you really start to like this image. There comes also a time that you don't like it anymore, but okay. But I mean, it's nice to have these kind of useful photographs that are normally used for a total different purpose, to take them out of its context and then put them in a magazine or hang them on your wall or whatever. And so with a group of five people, we kind of collected these images. And this one is also a favorite of mine. Very, very useful and also very beautiful, I think. And then in the end, the impossible happened, but they asked us to make exhibitions with it. That was not the purpose, but also on the wall of a gallery and in an exhibition, they work quite nice because it's, you just take them out of its original context. Yeah, I'll show you some issues. This is the second one, which was totally about photographs from that we pulled from eBay. Now it's quite common, but this was made like about 8 years ago, where suddenly you saw that, I mean, when you looked, when you typed in chair, you got like 14,000 images of a chair. And then when you look 2 weeks later, those images are gone, but there are 14 or 20,000 more new ones of them. So we got interested in photographs where people use their homes as a studio. And you get the most strange sceneries because they have to make, I mean, they're amateur photographers, but they have to make the best out of what they can do with their camera and how to present their stuff, the stuff that they want to sell. So often also like the bed cover or like a tablecloth, which is white, is used to present something on, or sometimes they put like a little coin next to an item just to show the size of it. Or like a piece of white paper to lighten it up, the background. And I mean, this is one of my favorites. It's like two crucifixes on a bench with a ruler in between, in between them. I mean, there's nobody who would ever, no professional photographer who would ever come up with an idea to take a picture like this. But I think it's yeah, also wonderfully naive. And why would you ever think that a ruler and two crucifixes get together on a bench? I mean, I just see the poetry of this as well. Another issue is on this cow or this bull called Lord Lily. And yeah, Lord Lily is a bull who for 12 years, he had to give his sperm twice or there four times a week for 12 years. He looks also pretty tired on this picture, but I mean, he got over 150,000 children in 12 years, and in this magazine we just present some of his daughters, and we found out that in every country all over the world there is a cow photographer. There's like a photographer who specialized in taking pictures of cows, and funny enough, they all do it in exactly the same way, because they always put a little bit of grass underneath the two legs, the two front legs, and that's just to straighten the back a little bit. And they don't use Photoshop, they use like, they have a bag of white and black hair just to patch the back a little bit. And often they have like an artificial tail with them. And it takes about half an hour to take a picture like this. And we made also a film about the, doesn't take half an hour, but like a short film about the Dutch cow photographer. And also here it shows like how difficult this is.
each chapter. It's about. En de voorkant van het blok ietsjes graag door het blok gooien. Oké. Okay. Staat erbij af en toe.
Yeah, he also has his car there, because when the cow is totally in the perfect position, he puts like a cassette tape in the car with cow sounds. So that makes the cow even more focused. So he's going to do that a little later. Very frustrating job, this. Yeah, that's the image. Yeah, one of the last issues is all about photographs that I found on pornographic websites. And these are the photographs that they show just before they encourage you to, or the photographs are there to encourage you to use your credit card, of course. And these photographs are kind of totally not sexually oriented, but they, in a way, they show a little bit like the acting skills of the so-called talent. And so you have all kinds of very stupid and bizarre sceneries, like these driving lessons here. And there's also like birthday parties, decorating parties, sewing parties, very strange sceneries. And but never very sexual, always. I mean, you know what's going to happen after, but in a way, almost these are more interesting because the pictures afterwards are always the same. And there's also, of course, the classic pizza delivery scene. It says like big sausage pizza on the right, just for your information. And here also there's, I mean, also bizarre, like a woman in a red dress pouring water over her from a coffee can. Why would she do that? I mean, so the whole magazine is full of these photographs, and it's quite fun. It's also very a bit embarrassing, but this was the best-selling issue. It sold out in two weeks, I think. Yeah, another series of books I want to talk about is that's in a way a little bit of a different fascination for imagery, but then photographs that I find either online or on flea markets, but always done by kind of amateurs. And in useful photography, you see often that the photographers are professionals. Here they are amateurs. And here I always am looking for kind of a certain sequence and a certain story they tell, almost by making these series of photographs in a very naive way themselves. They don't even know that they kind of made a record of these photographs after so many years. And then I kind of find them. It started with this book where I found in Barcelona on a flea market. It was around, I think, in around 2000. I found like 400 slides on a flea market of this woman. And I mean, I didn't look at them all, but they were very properly conserved, and it started to rain at the market, so I thought like I'll take them. And but at home, I found out that in almost every picture there was this woman, and it was clearly like a kind of a photographic love story of a husband with his wife. And they kind of, for 12 years, they made this sequence of photographs. And also there were never kind of children involved in the photographs, so there are certain strange stories in there. Here she's like holding a rose in her mouth. Quite strange, because there are no roses there growing, so they must have kind of made this kind of amateur photo shoot out of it. Or at least they didn't think it was amateur, but... And then, I mean, there are many bathing suits she's wearing over the years. And one funny thing was also that in the beginning of the book, because the book itself I edited totally in time, and in the beginning of the book you see her always very prominent in the images. But then later in the book she becomes much smaller. So it's almost when you use it as a flip book, you see her like getting smaller and smaller. So this can have only two reasons, like either he lost a lot of interest in his subject, or he got a lot of more interest for the background. Because in the last picture of the book, she's totally disappeared, and she's almost in a tree there. And then I had like, after, I mean, I didn't make the book immediately, because I thought like, I had those images for some years, and I thought like, yeah, what? I showed it to many people, and everybody loved it, and everybody made his own story about it. But I thought like, yeah, can I publish a book of it? And it was also kind of obvious that they wouldn't be alive anymore, because at least that's what I thought. But in the book, I wrote that if the pictures would be from them or the family, or then I would return them. But then in the end, I made the book. I had an exhibition in Barcelona, and then I thought also to make like an invite and a poster to ask like, if you know this woman, please come to the gallery. And then so in Barcelona and even in a national newspaper, there was kind of a lot of attention for it, and they called her Senora X. And they thought it was strange that somebody from Holland was kind of looking for this woman. And they called her La Mujer Misteriosa. And she was also like in the news there. And I was also interested in how... I was interested in how these images get like a second and a third life. So after the exhibition, during the exhibition, like a woman came to the gallery, and she was in her 70s, and she said that she remembered the woman in the photographs because she used to work with her in a telephone company, and the name of the woman in the photographs was Josefina Iglesias, and she also knew that she died some 10 years before, and then her husband also died soon after. They had no children. They always went on holiday in Spain. So, I mean, that kind of completed the story. But then I got also more interested in that these images that you just pick up from a market and that they get like a second, a third, a fourth, and a fifth life almost, because like here, Agnes B made some t-shirts. She really liked the project. She made some like limited t-shirts of Josefina. And I mean, also she got in exhibitions. And so that kind of triggered me. And in that way, I came also to a next book, which was found by a student who lived above a taxi driver. And the taxi driver died, and he kind of saved all the slides from this taxi driver. And they were very, very special. There were 700 slides, and on every slide there was this Mercedes taxi, so his taxi. And he had like one client that he drove around like for some years, some days in a year. And it was a Dutch woman who lived in his town, and he drove her through Germany, Switzerland, and Austria. And but then during the travels, he always stepped out of the car and took a picture of the Mercedes taxi. very strange, I thought. But then I found out also that on all of the images, on all 700 images, the woman was sitting in the car. So, I mean, even here where it's difficult to see, but yeah, you still see your face, the back of her head here. And so she was always sitting next to the driver, and the driver walked out and took a picture. And some very beautiful images, I think. And sometimes she looked at him, sometimes she was asleep. And then even with sunset, she was in the car or at night. And then there was also one image that she took from the taxi driver, and that's this one. And it's here you also clearly see that she took it from the car. So she was sitting in the car while taking the picture. But this was also a curious story. So I found out that, because I did some research finding out who this woman was, because he had a little notebook with her name in there where he kept the kilometers that he was driving for her. And then I found out that the woman was handicapped. And so in a way, for many years, I mean, he made her holiday pictures. Yeah, the only problematic thing, of course, was that the Mercedes taxi was around her. But I mean, at least this was the second best option to do. But it was nice to see like how sometimes people have this idea, do that for years and years, and then yeah, I thought as a sequence, it's very nice to put together in a book without any copy, a little bit of copy to explain the story at the back of the book. But it's almost like a photo novel where you have to make your own story. In this book, that happened as well. By the way, all the books that I made now, 12 of these books, and they're all called in almost every picture. It's not very smart, but I mean, I couldn't find another better title for everyone. So I just kept them all the same title, only the subject is different. Here, I found also on a flea market albums, many albums of these non-identical twins, also from Barcelona. And they took for many years photographs where they were both wearing the same, but they totally don't look the same because one head bigger than the other. And but it's bizarre to see, like, yeah, this was around like 1939, 1940. It was bizarre to see that there was, I mean, that they had such a special eye for their clothing and for being together. And then at a certain moment, they also got a boyfriend. I didn't know which boyfriend, where the boyfriend belonged to, but then the next photograph, because on the back of the photographs, mostly there was a date written. The next photograph is this one, where the boyfriend becomes a soldier. And then the next one I found was this one. And then it was only the smaller one of the two only appearing on the photographs, and almost leaving like a little bit of a gap in the photograph for her, yeah, for her disappeared sister. Very strange, yeah, rather sad story. But I mean, there are more of these stories where, for instance, a twin gets separated because one girlfriend or one of the twins goes together with a soldier, or it happened before. But I mean, that they documented it like this is quite special, I think. And then sometimes, also, I did exhibitions with these series also to show them. And then, for instance, here I made like the cut. So where the one sister disappeared, I made that in the corner, and here is like Josefina on the wall of a gallery, and the taxi driver. Yeah, another same title in almost every picture is photographs I found on online, and these are from a Japanese photographer who was also an amateur. These were made like in the beginning when there was the digital camera, and also this was one of the first weblogs, photo blogs that he made, because every day there was a new image of his rabbit called Oolong, the rabbit, and because he found out that the rabbit can balance everything on his head. And I mean, every day he would post a new photograph on his weblog with something on his head, and I mean, it got stranger and stranger over the years, and I mean, the photographer had also a preference for cookies, I think, but I mean, going to the site every day and pulling the image off makes your day really happy, of course, especially with this one. Huh? And then one day I found out there was this image on there because Oolong got sick. And that was also something that you could follow then every day. And it's going to get very sad soon. So one day there was this image on the site. But then there was, I thought this was the end of it, but I checked the next day if there was still a new image on there, and there was the last image on there the next day, that's this one. And there are two carrots, by the way. It's not his ears, but here it shows also like a certain photographical story that I think it's nice to also publish in the book, because in a way, I mean, you could say like, why can't you see these photographs online? Because they are online. But I mean, here they are on the site. They are totally surrounded with all kinds of colors and a very terrible site, and which is fine. But it's nicer to see them in a sequence and more quiet. And I think that was better to then take it again a little out of its context and then see it in a book. After that, of course, the book can be again like a digital book, which most of these are, and that's fine, but that's only the carrier. I mean, the content and the edit, I think, is more important. Another one is on this this woman called Ria van Dijk, and this is the woman on the right on the image there. And Ria, she when she was 16, she started to shoot in a shooting gallery on a funfair. I don't know if you have that system here, but you go and shoot in the funfair in a shooting gallery, and if you hit the bullseye, it takes a picture of you while shooting. And so Ria, after she was 16, she did this every year. And I mean, and she kept them all, because in the beginning they were like negatives that were taken, and she had to collect them the next day. And but later, of course, they became Polaroids and more instant photographs. But in a way, she kind of documented her whole life. She never had a camera, by the way. And but through the photographs, you see the photography changing. You see people changing, and yeah, it's a remarkable story, I think. I heard of Ria from somebody, and I visited her, and then I asked her, showed her the other books, asked her if I could make this book, and she was really happy with that. Here, I mean, you always see these guns lying there as well, but at a certain moment you see a walking stick appearing in the photograph. So you can tell a lot of things, like that she became older. She also got smaller in the image, but that had another reason. And here, here Ria is in her... She lives in an elderly house in Tilburg, in a small town in Holland. And after the book was published, the photographs got interest, or the Museum of Modern Art in Amsterdam got interested in buying the photographs, which was also kind of a bit of a scandal in the newspaper, because a lot of other professional photographers, they were like complaining because every 3 years the museum buys like a collection, or buys for some money, they buy photography, but this year most of the money went to Ria, because she sold her whole collection of these 70 Polaroids, and yeah, Ria was really happy, you know. I mean, for 2 years she spent all the money. She kind of went to gave parties, bus trips for friends, dinners, and it's all gone now, the money. Ria is still alive. She's like now 94 years old, and sometimes she goes with me to these exhibitions, because the exhibition toured to many places. I mean, now it's in London, it went in Beijing, in Berlin. Ria's really like, in her hometown, she's really like a star, and a shooting star. And here, I mean, in England, they also called her the woman who shoots herself, Ria van Dijk. Yeah, two last books to finish. This is a book, it works also quite nice with this light, but this is a book about a family who is kind of fighting with one of the big mysteries within photography. And it's, yeah, it's like how to shoot my black dog. So they totally failed all their life to shoot their black dog. I mean, the whole thing is like a big disaster. And I mean, they also chose to buy a black couch, and then that doesn't help, of course. So it's like only one big mistake. Very sad. And also when they went outside, you think like it's daylight, but then the dog went into the shade, and then it got black again. But then there was in that album, I found it in New York, and also on a flea market, and in that album was one image where they got, anyway, they got so frustrated they started to overexpose all the images. And then there was one image where finally everything is white, but then the dog, at least he looks at you. And so that's a nice ending ending to the book. Yeah, the last, I think this is the 11th book I did. I found that recently, also again on internet. I found this couple from Florida. They live in a town called Clearwater, which makes it quite, that's also quite special if you're going to know the rest of the story soon, because this is Fred and Valerie. So Fred is the photographer and Valerie is the model, but not like you saw with Josefina before, because Fred, he has like a kind of a preference to photograph Valerie in the water. And then, I mean, it started very humble. This was like in 1980 and then 1981. So, because later he really wanted her with all her clothes in the water. And then he did that for many years. I mean, they played around in creeks and in rivers, and I mean, in public fountains at night, he flashed a photograph, and she secretly went in there. And then, I mean, in the rain, like, it went more bizarre. With the leather jacket, with the cowboy hat. I mean, even in the winter, in the swimming pool. I mean, and the beautiful, the photographs are like, almost like Ophelia, you know? Like the famous painting. Here also, with the handbag. This one also, it's, I think, beautiful photograph. And then I kind of contacted them to say, like, if I could make the book with these photographs. And they kind of liked it. Not straight away, but I mean, he got into the idea after a while, Fred. And but then I thought it's nice to, when I make the book, then I wanted to, I printed like 400 copies of the book on plastic, because I thought it's great if I send the book to them, that they can make a picture with the book again in the water. And then, because that was my kind of kick then out of it. So I did that, and Fred sent me an email. He said, like, I've sent a dozen of photos from our afternoon book swim. I hope they meet what is needed for publicity photos. I have Photoshop touched them up for good presentations, and I shot well over 100 views, and these are the best. The shoot went well. We were both in the mood. There was a light overcast, as hoped for, with no harsh shadows. Valerie wanted to know if the book was really to go into the water. I said yes. The book slipped down into the water a little bit at a time, Valerie taking it and herself in deeper as the photos progressed. Eventually, she was fully under. We enjoyed the tantalizing intrigue of it. I forgot to tell them, by the way, that the book was printed on plastic, so they were really wondering if it could go into the water. So they were like staying with the book in the water, and they didn't have a clue that it was on plastic. So after the photo sequence, he said, like, we both swam with the book, looking again at each picture. The water was not seeming to have any effect on it. We must have enjoyed 2 hours in the water with it. I rinsed it off in the house, dried off each page, and placed paper towel pieces between each page. The book seems to have withstood the lengthy adventure just fine. Loved the whole business, Fred and Valerie. I mean, these kind of emails made me very happy. And then there was finally the photographs of the shoot where they just played around with the book in the water. And this was like my favorite one. And thank you very much.
Ja, vielen Dank, Erik. Sind noch Fragen? Hat jemand noch eine Frage?
So, ja. Auf Deutsch.
Ja.